Take your Bibles, hope, and wrong message. I did that already. Okay. Open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. This morning we take prayer requests and we take we receive praise and worship, and we were talking this morning about how we've had opportunity with several different members. We've had opportunity to be a witness and testimony to others in this world, many of whom we never met before, but we simply took the opportunity to be a witness and testimony. Ephesians chapter 5. Verse 8 talks about that. Chapter 5, verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, Awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. I want to speak just a few minutes here this morning about ye are light in the Lord. Ye are light in the Lord. Let's pray. God, teach us, speak to our hearts, convict us. May we respond accordingly. May we desire to have a fellowship with you. May we desire to truly know you so much that we know how to respond and how to walk in this world. God, I pray that we would all see that we are to be the light in this world, in the Lord. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Probably one of the biggest problems in our churches today is we've seemingly lost power. But not our power. We've lost His power. It's still there. It's still there. But look around us. We promise to make, by the teaching of God's Word and we live our lives that we'll make men different. We'll make men different. Stop and ask yourself this question. Of my circle of friends, my influence, who of those around me are different because I have been light? Because I have been light. Who of those are different? We live in a world of in a country of moral decay. We're killing babies. We're same sex marrying the same sex. I mean, I usually say we've lost our minds. But we've lost that influence of God in our lives. The church has lost its influences in this world because Christians have neglected the responsibility to be the light in the world. The world's not going to make us better. I heard somebody talking the other day, and he was talking about how to fix all these problems, and what we need is have more education, better education, and I think, no. You need to turn your heart to God. You need to receive Christ as your Savior, and then to begin to grow in Him. The problem is that we have, our churches are full of Christians that are saved, but they just got in the door. It's as if they're saved, but that's as far as they take the relationship with God. How can you be the light of the world if you're not in this book? How do you know what is right to do? You've got to spend time in this book. G. Campbell Morgan said this, "The church did the most for the world when the church was least like the world." What do we have nowadays? We have churches that are trying to put on a wonderful program. I have nothing wrong with music. I love music. But it's almost like it's a performance. It's almost as if we're trying to manufacture a worship time. No, it doesn't come that way. My love for God comes out of my heart from what he's done for me. And I desire to do those things. Similarly, when I'm out and about, and I mentioned to my class that I've been trying to do a little walking, trying to get a little exercise in, and this man joined himself to me. And I'm going, what is this? Lord, I need to walk. I need to walk. Thomason Alice, I'm going to try to exercise. And I realized God was saying, me first. Me first. So I slowed down the pace, and we talked about the Lord. I was able to share with him the gospel. But we need to be the light in this world. We need to be the light. When Paul wrote to this church in Ephesus, he knew they were a city, and a city that was filled with darkness. How could such a tiny band of believers make a difference? Well, here in Ephesus, it was home of the world-famous Temple of Artemis, or Temple Diana. It was quite a facility. It was one of the wonders of the world at that time. But God told us, that said, you're the light of the world. We're to walk as children of light. We're to let our light shine, because the light that shines will dispel the darkness. You know, some people won't like that. Some people won't like it that you'll point out their sinful ways. But you go ahead and shine your light anyway. Because I answer to God. I don't answer to men. I answer to God. What worked in the first century still works today. We've got to find a way to get a hold of his power. How do you do that? You get in his word, and you believe his word, and then you become light because God has done something. In verse 8 it says, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Again, there's one of those other commandments, another commandment. Walk as children of light. Not a suggestion. Walk as children of light. Doesn't mean you're perfect. It just simply means that you're going to try to promote God's word. We have a beautiful picture here of conversion. Coming to Christ is like walking from the darkness into a room filled with blazing light. When you were saved, you've come out of the darkness. Now you're saved. Now in the light. Now that we're in the light, we must put off the deeds of darkness. Yeah, there's a problem. There's a problem. We dress up nice. We look good. But in our heart are filled with deeds of darkness still. We were singing the chorus in that song. Be the heart, my heart, let my heart be your throne. That's what we need to be this morning. Verse 9 says, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. Goodness touches how we deal with others. That's goodness. Righteousness should involve a new commitment on our part to follow God's command. And truth demands a deep commitment to live with integrity. Verse 10, we have a new goal, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. No longer can we say, if it feels good, do it. No longer can we say, but everyone else is doing it. No longer can we say, I don't care what others think. You see, when Jesus Christ saved you on purpose, not just to take you to heaven immediately, but to serve him. And he's left us here. He sprinkled this earth with his children. And we are to be light. We're no longer a free agent to do what I want to do. You know, in sports, years ago, they started this free agency, which has, you know what it's done? It's taken away the dynasties. It used to be that you could put together a team and you have a group of ball players, whether it's football, baseball, basketball, and you could put together, unless you're the Warriors, they're pretty good. But anyway, you put together these teams. And then they said free agencies. And these free agents would say, I have a pretty good year. And these other teams will say, I'd like to bring you on to my club. And so they make these decisions. And they've weakened it. the ability to have a dynamic team. But we as Christians are no longer free agents to do what we want to do. We can't just do what we want to do. We believe that there's a God in heaven who has spoken, and that his word is authoritative, and that he has the absolute right to determine our moral choices. What we eat, what we drink, and I'm just going to say it, who we have sex with. That's what it's talking about here in this portion of Scripture. It's one of these hard things. I don't like talking about it, but I need to preach the whole counsel of God. How we spend our money and all the other choices we make. The world will find this strange, kind of mysterious. Maybe it's dangerous. But we need to allow God to rule our life. I don't want to get ahead of myself here, but when it comes to things like who we sleep with, we believe that God has clearly spoken and described what fornication is, what adultery is, what is wrong, the way we live our life sexually. Homosexual behavior is so prevalent nowadays, or at least it's promoted. It's almost, the world would have you think that you're stepping up in class almost by becoming a homosexual. God says it is an abomination. Adultery is wrong. We believe something that the world rejects. The world say, I can do anything I want. Sure you can. But you will have to answer to God at some point in time. That's why we can't support gay marriage. Do you love the person that's a homosexual? Absolutely. But I love them just like the Christian that comes to church and has nothing but hatred in their heart, but they put on a form of godliness. I love them the same way. It's still wrong. Still wrong. Actually, gay marriage does not exist in the eyes of God. Did you know that? Doesn't make any difference what the government says. Doesn't make any difference what law they pass. It is against God, and God is not for it. But he's not for he's not for the drunkard. He's not for in that sense. He's not for those that beat their wives. We need to pray, God, show me how to live today. Show me how to live today. Tomorrow we're going to get up and we're going to get about our duties. You're going to be engineering. You know, he doesn't wear a little hat. Okay. I don't know if you do or not. An engineer's hat. Pull the train. But whatever it is you get up tomorrow to do, keep in mind, am I living for God? Am I being light in this world? Am I being light? Well, something we see here is that light exposes. In verses 11 and 12, it says, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. Some things shouldn't be mentioned in public. Paul was thinking here about the temple, also called Diana, located in Ephesus. One of the seven worlds. One of the seven wonders in the ancient world, I'm told. It drew worshipers, and it drew tourists. People would come and look at this. But it was filled with idolatry and every sort of sexual excess. I'm afraid to say, but I think that we're not very far from that right now. And in our Christian churches. It's no wonder we don't have power. It's no wonder why men's lives are not being changed. Why? We're living just like them. does no good, people, to come to church here, excuse me, and dress up and clean up nice, and then live like you want to through the week. You need to be light. You need to be light. The world is not going to do it. Your neighbor is not going to do it. You need to be light. See, the light of the gospel exposes evil for what it really is. And that's why it's a shame we are talking about churches that do not preach the whole counsel of God. And they water down the doctrine of God, or perhaps they just kind of don't even mention it, and they push it off to the side. How are we going to know what evil is? Left to my own devices, I don't know what evil is. In my own self, my heart is desperately wicked and evil. I must have God's word. I must be light. And I must ask him to teach me how to live today. We need to take Paul seriously, his warning seriously. We need to recognize, we need to be able to identify clearly what evil is. Homosexuality is evil. Adultery is evil. Fornication is evil. Abusing your wife is evil. Verbally. Or physically. Another thing you brought up this morning and made me think, you know, is a lot of time men, we grab a hold of that. The wife is supposed to, she's at help meeting. She's supposed to, and we treat her just like she's a slave. I got to tell you something. Your wife is a child of God. And you better be careful how you treat her. Because there'll come a day you'll stand before God and you'll have to give an account. Satan's tricky. In Galatians 6:1, it says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye that are, which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness." And we stop there a lot of times. We go, "Gotta help that person. Gotta help that person." But sometimes we go into it as if like we're going to a gunfight with no bullets in our gun. Because the last part of that says, "Lest thou also be tempted." In our zeal to help the hurting, we ignore that phrase. And Satan is tricky. You know, that's why doctors, when they go to do surgery, they wash their hands so often. You always see them washing their hands. Washing their hands. They're not just OCD. They're just washing their hands. They're trying to avoid giving germs to the patient. But also, they're cleaning up because they don't want to get the patient's germs transferred to them. In our attempt to help others, we need to be careful lest we make excuses and we avoid confrontation. And sometimes we, as Christians, we'll do this. We'll go to a person to try to help them out, and we'll display sympathy, but we'll forget to bring truth along. You hear what I'm saying? We'll go ahead and we'll sympathize with them. We'll try to comfort them. But you know what? We need to bring the truth along. That's what's going to make difference in their life. Verse 13 describes the result of ministry of reproof. It says, "But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth not make manifest is light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light." God's word makes it clear. Not my sympathy. Not my coming over and just trying to comfort you. God's word makes it clear. It's not hard to understand this principle. When you have a little child in a dark room and they begin to cry, you know, how many of you remember our children doing that? It's dark in here. The parent comes in and turns on the light. And the light dispels the darkness. Shows whether there's evil in there or not. Parent goes around and looks under the bed, looks in the closet. Everything's all right. The monsters of his imagination, this child's imagination, vanishes when that light is turned on. And we need to apply this to the spiritual realm. See, sexual sin often seems pleasurable. You know why? Because it's done in secret. It's done in secret. But what happens when those emails come to light? What happens when those conversations come to light? What happens when someone says, but? Someone once said, you're only as sick as your secrets. You're only as sick as your secrets. When that light comes in and opens up that there was a sexual sin, that romance of it sure fades away very quickly. You know, you can't get better, Christian, until you tell yourself the truth. You need to look at yourself in this God's spiritual mirror so that you can see if you're clean. And if there's any wicked way in you, reveal it to me, God. Why? Because you're salt and you are light. We shouldn't be surprised when some people resent us for shining God's light in their life. Who are you to judge me? Well, actually, I'm nobody. But I happen to have the truth here. God calls us to shine the light of his truth and let it judge the human heart. Let it do the judging, not us. Remember, the word of God is like a two-edged sword, Hebrews chapter 4, verses 12 and 13. And it cuts through all the nonsense. It cuts through all the lies. It reveals all the deception. And it opens up and reveals the evil that's in every human heart. You say, but it hurts to be cut by a sword. It does. It does. You know, that's why you have people going to fill in churches and filling buildings, assemblies of people, filling buildings, because there's no strong preaching. I need to lay it out just like it says. It's no wonder we get labeled as fundamentalists or bigots or hate mongers. Oh, you're just, you know, how much of the time do you hear on the news now if you stand against abortion, if you stand against homosexuality, they even want to take your freedom of speech away. And they call you a hate monger. You're a bigot. It's not true. Satan has blinded their eyes. You see, the truth hurts. The truth hurts. And the truth will hurt you before it heals you. That's the difference. We have God's truth here. And if we'll lay it out there, it'll hurt. But it has the ability to heal people. The last phrase, verse 13, suggests that light actually has transforming power. First, light penetrates and scatters the darkness. Then it illuminates the hidden evil, shows you what the evil is. And then it's interesting, the light begins to change the very thing that it shined upon. And that's what the light of God's word does to us, folks. He revealed to me my need of salvation. I was saved, and the light came into me. But now as I study his word, he continues shining a light. And let me show you this corner of your heart here. Let me point out this area in your life. Now, we have a decision to make. When that happens, what do? Do we respond to it? You know, as I preach or I teach, or anyone comes in here and preaches and teaches, it's done because we believe this is what God has us to say. And we're trying to preach the truth as it is written. But you have a responsibility once you've heard something. Or even if you are driving down the road and you're communing with God's Holy Spirit and he reveals something to you, you're responsible to deal with that. See, darkness can only produce more darkness. But light can cause darkness to become light. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? When God turns on the light in my life, when he turned on the light in my life, the darkness was gone forever. Verse 14 says, wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepeth and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. Shall give thee light. W.A. Criswell, the old Southern Baptist preacher, used to preach that Ephesians 5:14 and John 3:16, that both verses contain the essential truth we need to know about salvation. and you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sin, it tells us in Ephesians 2:1. A man who is dead cannot raise himself. He must be quickened. And that's what I had to be. I had to be quickened. I had to be made alive. And only Christ can do that. And only Christ can do that. That's the transforming power of the gospel of Christ. First, the light comes into us, and it transforms us from light to darkness. Secondly, the light shining through us chases away the darkness in my life. It should. Where are you compared to a week ago in your spiritual walk? Have you grown? Where are you compared to a month ago? Where are you compared to a year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago? Now, some of you have not been saved that long. But where are you in your Christian walk? Are you allowing the light of God's word to shine into your life and chase away the darkness out of your life, that you can be the light in the Lord? John 3:19 says this, and this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. Sad, but many Christians love darkness. Should not be. Should not be. It's our human nature to fight the light of God. And the third thing is, light awakens those who are asleep and raises them from the dead. Raises them from the dead. There was a man named Naeem Fazal. He was a Pakistani Muslim raised in Kuwait, and he became a Christian. Before his conversion, he heard that his older brother had become a Christian. You know what his response was? He said, I wanted to kill him. Now, you know what? If I had just happened into this world somehow and had no idea of any of the religions of the world, and I looked over here and this one over here wants to kill you, and this one over here wants to give you everything that God has, I would hope that I would go to this one. But what a religion that to be a part of. That he'd want to kill his only brother, his older brother that had become a Christian. He said he got so angry that he actually threatened to kill him. But that anger turned out to be the first step in a long journey that led him to Jesus. He's now a pastor. As you witness to your friends, don't be startled or don't be surprised if they get a little bit angry with you. Okay? And I think that's what we're afraid of. Who do you fear, though, this morning? Do you fear men or do you fear God? Really? I think if God were judging here this morning, he would say, most of you fear men. You don't fear me. You don't fear me. Don't be startled. Better that they get angry with you than you never tell them the truth. Robert Louis Stevenson, when he was a young child, he was sick most of the time, they said, and he had a nurse that would care for him and take care of him. And she came to his room one evening, and he was looking out the window. As the man came down and he was lighting the gas lamps, she said, "What are you doing?" He looked at her and he said, "I'm watching the man knock holes in the darkness. I'm watching the man knock holes in the darkness." What a beautiful picture that is. Christian, are you knocking holes in the darkness this morning? Are you the light in the Lord that you should be? The world doesn't want the light, but it desperately needs it. Let's pray.